I would like to invite your attention to the book of 2 Kings chapter 8, the book of 2 Kings chapter 8. I just want to read a few verses of scripture, and I just can't get away from what I feel the Lord has laid upon my heart to bring to you today. I pray it will be a blessing to you. But 2 Kings chapter 8, and we'll begin at the first verse. The word of the Lord says this: Then spake Elisha unto the woman, whose son he had restored to life, saying, Arise, and go thou and thine household, and sojourn wheresoever thou canst sojourn. For the Lord hath called for a famine, and it shall also come upon the land 7 years. And the woman arose and did after the saying of the man of God, and she went with her household and sojourned in the land of the Philistines 7 years. And it came to pass at the 7 years' end that the woman returned out of the land of the Philistine, and she went forth to cry unto the king for her house and for her land. And the king talked with Gehazi, the servant of the man of God, saying, Tell me, I pray thee, all the great things that Elisha hath done. And it came to pass, as Gehazi was telling the king how Elisha had restored a dead body to life, that behold, the woman whose son he had restored to life cried to the king for her house and for her land. And Gehazi said, My lord, O king, this is the woman, and this is her son, whom Elisha had restored to life. And when the king asked the woman, she told him. So the king appointed unto her a certain officer, saying, Restore all that was hers, and all the fruits of the field, since the day she left the land, even until now. Hallelujah. I'd like to concentrate our attention on this thought about that passage. And my subject tonight is going to be this: the testimony of Gehazi. The testimony of Gehazi. Could we just lift up our voices unto the Lord and ask His blessing upon the preaching of His word? God, I thank You for Your rich and wonderful blessing that has come to us in so many ways. God, I thank You for every person that is gathered in this place. Pour out Your blessing upon us. Let Your word speak to our hearts. Help us, I pray in Jesus' name, to draw closer to You, to have a greater faith when we walk out of here today than maybe what we did when we arrived. God, I pray that there'll be a life-changing power of Your Spirit to come through Your word. In the precious and matchless name of Jesus, we pray. And the church said, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. And amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the name of the Lord. Now, Gehazi is one of those names in the Bible that perhaps didn't make it through to 2023 as one of the more popular names to name your child. It just didn't make it, maybe, but it's one of those King James names that we hear and we have to try to make sure we're pronouncing it correctly. And so it's unique. It has 6 letters and 3 syllables. That's quite a lot of moving around when you're talking about a name when you have 6 letters and 3 syllables. And, of course, it will have a Z in it, and if it's a good Old Testament Bible name. And so we're not maybe as familiar with the name Gehazi as we are some of the other great figures in the Word of God. But I want to talk to us a little bit about this man, Gehazi. To understand Gehazi and the significance of his place in the scriptures, you have to understand the man of God that he served, whose name was Elisha. And to understand Elisha, you have to understand the man of God that he served, named Elijah. These 3 men have a bond in the significance of the sequence of their place in the scriptures. So let's talk first about Elijah. Elijah was, of course, a great prophet in the Word of God. I love how his story starts. His story starts by simply saying Elijah, one of the inhabitants of Gilead. Not a tremendous pedigree or resume introduces him to the scriptures, but he's just one of the inhabitants of Gilead. But God was able and God purposed to pour out an anointing upon just one of the inhabitants of Gilead. Lets us know that we don't always have to have the most impressive background for God to lay his hand of favor upon us. Just one of the inhabitants of Gilead, Elijah, steps onto the scene of the scriptures and shifts the discussion, the paradigm of people's thinking, causes everyone to come to a screeching halt, and particularly he was calling Israel to a place of repentance. And he did, and he did so many times through the working of miracles. The miracles that he performed were just spectacular. We if you ever hear the term calling fire from heaven, that concept comes from the life of the prophet Elijah. Elijah called fire from heaven, and he did so under distressful circumstances. He was up against 400 false prophets of Baal, and they were calling upon their god Baal to perform this miracle. Of course, he was unable to do so because he's a false god. And Elijah said, "Let the God that answers by fire, let him be God." And of course, he called fire from heaven after he had poured 12 barrels of water upon an altar of 12 stones. And fire came down, and the Bible says the fire licked up the water that was upon the altar. He not only called fire from heaven, but he prayed, and the Lord shut up the heavens for the space of 3.5 years. And he prayed again, and the Lord opened the heavens, and there was the sound of an abundance of rain. Elijah's miracles are quite storied, and they were pivotal in Israel's return to God. And he is often in the scriptural text in rare company. The company that he shares is quite impressive. For instance, he and another man are the only men that we know of that we have no record of them dying. They did not die. The Bible says that by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death. God, he walked with God, and God took him because he pleased God. That was his testimony. Elijah was caught up by a whirlwind and chariots of fire took him off into the glory of God somewhere, and he just never did die along with Enoch. And he also shared the Mount of Transfiguration along with Moses, Jesus being in the middle, and they spoke about the things that Jesus was about ready to undertake. And there stands Moses, who no doubt represents the law, Elijah, who many believe, and he did represent the prophets. And they're conversing with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. They're translucent as they stand there, long after Moses and Elijah were upon the earth. And not only did he share company with Moses and Enoch, but he shared company with the great John the Baptist. John the Baptist, whom Jesus spoke of when he said that there was not a greater prophet born of a woman than John the Baptist. And Jesus said, and in fact, when you look at John the Baptist, you're basically looking at the ministry of Elijah returned to the earth, calling Israel to a place of repentance. Elijah, this mighty man of God, but you can't talk about Elijah without talking about Elisha. Elisha was the man that poured water upon the hands of Elijah. Elisha was the man that God told Elijah to go put his mantle upon him while he plowed with 12 yoke of oxen. And Elisha was no doubt the favored successor to the ministry, the unprecedented ministry of Elijah. And the day came when Elijah would in fact be taken by God in a whirlwind, chariot of fire, And he was going to move on from this place, and Elisha knew it. And Elisha made a request that we would do well to take note of. He said, I pray thee, give me a double portion of your spirit. When we talk about a double portion, we get that language from this experience that 2 Kings chapter 2 describes, where Elisha looks at Elijah and says, before you go, I want a double portion of your spirit. That's quite a request. And Elijah responded by saying, you have asked a hard thing. And it is a hard thing. How do you give double of what you only have one of? But that's what Elisha was asking for. I want a double portion. Whatever it is you got, I want a double portion of it. And Elijah said, you can have it if you see me ascend into the fire and the wind. And I want you to know that if you experience the fire and the wind of the Holy Ghost, you today can have a double portion. I want you to know that if you'll let the wind of God, hallelujah, I'm glad to be an east wind today. There's a reason why you're east wind, because the wind blows in this house and the wind blows from this house all across this region. And the fire falls here, and you can have a double portion. You can have more than enough. You can have life in that more abundantly. You can have your cup running over. You can have good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. I'm talking about a double portion. Anybody believe in a double portion? The God of more than enough. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord is my provider. Oh, let me remind somebody today that my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. Hallelujah. I want a double portion, Elisha said. And Elijah said, you get a hold of the fire and you get a hold of the wind and you can have more than you could ever imagine. And so it happened just like that. Of course, that mantle fell. Elisha takes up the mantle. He smites the waters of the Jordan River and says, where be the Lord God of Elijah? And the waters part hither and thither. And off Elisha goes into the journey of fulfilling the double portion of Elijah's ministry. And he did perform exactly twice as many miracles as Elijah performed, the last of which coming after he was dead. While his bones lay in a grave and a soldier died, they took that soldier to the grave of the prophet Elisha and they threw that dead soldier into the grave of those old anointed bones of the prophet, where there was one more promise. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. That promise is going to come to pass. Even when you think it's dead and gone, the promise is still alive. God said, I'll give you a double portion, and there was one more miracle in those bones. I want you to know God cannot lie. It is impossible for God to lie. When you lay hold to the precious, exceeding great promises of God, it will come to pass. It shall come to pass. And you, hallelujah, can rest assured that you can live your life like it has already come to pass. Oh, praise God. That double portion was just waiting to be fulfilled. And this life of Elisha was just, it was spectacular. It was double the number of miracles that Elijah had performed. And then you have Gehazi. And so Gehazi, my goodness, just imagine what's waiting him. I mean, we're talking about a quadruple portion. My goodness, he's going to get double of what Elisha had, which was double of what Elijah had. And he's a servant to Elisha in the same way that Elisha was a servant to Elijah. Now, when Elisha was a servant to Elijah, he just simply followed him. He walked with him. He would not leave him alone. He had total and full confidence in what Elijah said. And he washed his hands and he waited with bated breath for the next assignment. And Gehazi was the same way. Gehazi saw all of the miracles that Elisha had performed, and he was present for those miracles and was assistant to those miracles. He was present in the sense that when Elisha needed logistical work done for the miracle to come to pass, Gehazi was the guy that stepped into that role and said, what needs to go where? Where does it need to happen? What time do we need to have it there? Who do we need to talk to? And Gehazi just made things happen, dotted I's, crossed T's, and they worked so well as a team. Just imagine the quadruple portion that awaits Gehazi. And then an infamous moment occurs in the scriptures. All of these miracles that Gehazi was accompanied to and was privy to, one of the greatest miracles of Elisha happened, and Gehazi was an integral part of it, but it turned out not to go so well for Gehazi. It happened in the miracle performed for Naaman, the captain of the host of Syria. Naaman was a leper. And he heard from a young maid in Israel who worked for he and his wife that there was a prophet in Israel who could pray over him and could perform a miracle on his behalf. And when Naaman went to Israel to meet Elisha, do you know Elisha didn't even come down to meet Naaman? He sent Gehazi to meet with Naaman. And Naaman was actually kind of offended. He said, wait a minute, I came here to talk to Elisha. But Elisha, I don't know why he didn't meet with him. He just didn't meet with him. And he said, just go tell him to go wash, go dip 7 times in the Jordan River. And when he heard that he had to go to the Jordan River, he said, why would I go to the Jordan River when I'm surrounded by these beautiful rivers in my own land? It'd be like some of y'all coming up to Cincinnati, Ohio, and me saying, hey, we're going to take you to the Ohio River for a great day at the beach. You're going to say, you do know where I live, right? You do know what I'm accustomed to and what I, oh man, we're going to have a nice dinner down there at the Ohio River beach. And it wouldn't be as impressive to you, and it wasn't as impressive to Naaman. Because he said, where I come from, we have these beautiful rivers and these beautiful waterways, and we have all of these expansive and magnificent places that I could go dip in these waters. I think I'll just go there and do it. And Elisha said, it's got to be at the Jordan River. There was a spiritual significance in all of it. And ladies and gentlemen, this is why when the Bible tells you to be baptized in Jesus' name, Don't just dismiss that and say, no, I'll just do it any old way I want to do it. No, he means be baptized by immersion in water in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And so Naaman is about to leave. One of his servants comes to him and says, oh, king, oh, captain, I don't just walk away. We came all this way. The prophet told you what to do. If he had said something grand or great, you would have done that. But he's told you to do something quite humble, and now you're offended and you want to go away from him. But I implore you to listen to what the prophet has said. And Naaman agreed. Okay, fine. I'll go do what the prophet has told me to do. He goes down to the Jordan River, and famously, he dips 7 times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, nothing had changed. But on that 7th time, he came up out of that water. And the Bible says the leprosy was gone. And the Bible says that his flesh was restored to the flesh of a child. That means that there was no sign he ever did have leprosy. There was no sign he ever had acne. I mean, it was restored to the flesh of a child. There were no lacerations. There was no scarring. There was no sun damage. And I want you to know that that's what God wants to do for you today. He wants to restore your life to the faith of a child. Before the injuries came, before the abuse came, before the mistakes were made, before the problems started, God wants to take you back to a place of innocence and purity. Hallelujah. Naaman is so enthralled and elated at this glorious experience of healing and wholeness and restoration that he insists on paying Elisha and giving him money for what he had just received. And Elisha wouldn't receive the money. Elisha said, no, I want to prove to Naaman that there is a prophet in Israel. And listen, you know, it was a nice and kind gesture that Naaman made. But you know, the truth isn't for sale. And Elisha said, no, I want you, you're not going to own me when you walk away from here. You're just going to know God did something for you that nobody and nothing else could do for you. And Naaman goes away, and Gehazi is dumbfounded at what just happened. He looks at Elisha like, are you kidding me? He just, you know how much he just offered you? And he's got it. He's not going to miss it. That could have helped us. Elisha must be losing it a little bit. I don't know if Elisha's thinking things as clearly as he ought to think. And Gehazi kind of made him mad. And when Naaman goes off, Gehazi thought, you know what? Sometimes you just got to do what you got to do. And he goes running after Naaman and approaches him and lies to him. He's got a lie on his lips. And he said, listen, that great man Elisha, he got to thinking about your offer. And he wanted me to come tell you that we'd be very happy to receive what you offered. That wasn't true. And Naaman just pours all this abundance upon Gehazi. And Gehazi goes back and doesn't tell Elisha what happened. And Elisha says, hey, Gehazi, where have you been? And Gehazi said, oh, just kind of hanging out, kind of chilling, doing my thing. And Elisha said, no, I know where you've been. I know what you're up to. And he said, when you're dishonest like that, and when you interrupt and disrupt what God is doing in a person's life like that, he said, that's a major problem. And Elisha said, the leprosy that was on Naaman is now on you. And Gehazi has this leprosy that Naaman had. Naaman was just delivered from it, and now Gehazi has this leprosy. And apparently, there are different forms of leprosy. Not all leprosy requires isolation. So Naaman, for instance, was able to interact with people, and Gehazi apparently was, because we see him in 2 Kings chapter 8, and he's with the king, and he's talking to the king, and in 2 Kings chapter 5, he had this horrible experience of dishonesty, and he lied, and he was greedy, and he was envious of other people's wealth, and he coveted Naaman's goods, and he was just in violation of the nature and the goodness of God, and he brought leprosy upon himself and his family. He brought reproach upon himself, and so the scripture declares that, and it's sad because we're looking at a man who had so much going for him. A quadruple portion awaited him. An anointing unprecedented in his generation was just at his fingertips. He had exposure to one of the most amazing ministries recorded in the Word of God. He was being mentored and developed and trained by Elisha, the prophet of God, the servant of Elijah, who walked in a double portion of Elijah's anointing. And Gehazi, for just a little bit of wealth, a little bit of a windfall, a little bit of a financial boost, he sells it all out and brings reproach upon himself. And he now is subject to the things that other people are being delivered from. And I feel in the Holy Ghost that I'm preaching to somebody today who can relate to what Gehazi did and went through from that day forward. I believe there's somebody in this house who knows and feels and understands what it's like to make a mistake. You wish you could go back in time
and fix it up and do things differently. If I could just go back to that day when I made that terrible mistake, I wouldn't lie. I wouldn't be greedy. I wouldn't be dishonest. I wouldn't cave to the lusts of my flesh. I wouldn't cave to the lusts of my eyes. I wouldn't love money the way I loved money in that moment. If I could go back and restore my credibility with my family, if I could just go back and restore my credibility with friends and people that I had developed such favor with, if I could just go back and get back on the track that I was on before all of this nonsense started. And so no doubt Gehazi lived with regret. But here he is in 2 Kings chapter 8. In 2 Kings chapter 8, he's standing before the king. And the king is asking him, I want you to tell me about all the miracles of Elisha. Because Gehazi was there for all of them. He saw all of them. He knew all of them. He experienced them. He was present for the miracles that Elisha had performed. And now he's standing before the king, and the king says, I want to ask you about the miracles of Elisha. And let me tell you this morning, I don't know what you've been through, and I don't know what mistakes you've made, but if you've got an experience with God, then you have an experience with God. And nothing and nobody can take away from you the knowledge you have of the goodness of God. There's not a mistake you have made. There's not a problem you got yourself into. There's not a temptation you stumbled in. There's not a mistake you've made that can rip from you the knowledge you have that God is a miracle worker. I may have made some mistakes and I might have some problems in my past, but my eyes have seen the goodness and the glory of the Lord. I saw him save the lost. I saw him raise the dead. I saw him heal the sick. I saw him provide sustenance for those who were hungry. I'm going to tell somebody today, you might have regret, but you also have a testimony. You might have some mistakes in your past, but you also have a testimony that through it all, God has been good to me. The king said, Gehazi, tell me about all these miracles that Elisha performed. And Gehazi said, where do you want me to start? I know I might not be the best representation of his ministry. I know I might not be the best reflection, but I do have some stories to tell. Where you want me to start? I've got miracles for days. You want me to talk about the axe head that flew off the handle and plummeted to the bottom of the water? But that man of God called that axe head to the surface and put it back on the handle and put the axe back in the hand of the laborers. Where do you want me to start? You want me to tell you about the day they started eating the soup only to find out that the soup was toxic and poisonous and that there was death in the bowl of soup? But that man of God, I watched it with my own eyes, how that he put meal in the bowl and the soup was healed and they ate to their satisfaction. You want me to tell you about some miracles? Let me tell you about when the water of the city was naught and nobody had anything to drink, but that man of God put a cruse of salt inside that water and the waters of Jericho were healed. Where you want me to start? I'm going to tell you, there's some backsliders in this city who could tell you, I may not be where I want to be, and I may not reflect him the way I want to reflect him, but I was there. I was there when they threw the crutches down. I was there when they threw the needle away. I was there. I saw the demons cast out. I saw the blind eyes open. I watched it happen. I've got a testimony of the goodness of God. I got miracles for days. I got miracles for days. There Gehazi stands gnarled with leprosy. There Gehazi stands wounded from his own mistakes, wounded from his own deception, lost his credibility, lost the health in his body. People don't talk about Gehazi the way they talk about Elijah and Elisha, but they would have been heralding him to a greater degree if he had stayed on the track he was on. We need to understand, though, that that mistake doesn't define you. That is not the definition of your life. The accuser of the brethren will come up alongside you and tell you that when you committed adultery, that you're an adulterer forever. I'm going to tell you that when you repent of that sin and are baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, I want you to know, yo, you are innocent. You are blameless. You are holy and pure. And I want you to know that if you committed sin after you were born of the water and of the Spirit, the Lord is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin if you'll confess it to Him. Now, if you're a Bible student here and you love to study the Word of God, and I know Eastwind loves the Word of God, you'll know who I'm talking about when I talk about the demoniac. But he's not a demoniac anymore. You'll know who I'm talking about when I talk about the woman with the issue of blood. But she doesn't have an issue of blood anymore. You know who I'm talking about when I talk about doubting Thomas. But he's not doubting anymore. You hear what I'm telling you? I don't know what you've been through, but that doesn't have to define you. You can overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. He said, I got miracles. I got miracles. I got miracles. I've got more. Let me thumb through the pages here and tell you about some more miracles. I was there. I wish you could have been there with me on the front porch when the Syrian army was surrounding Elisha's house, and I was terrified. Man, I can't even describe the feeling, Brother Richie, that Gehazi had inside of him when he's looking at those chariots all around the house. But Elisha walks out, rubs his eyes, yawns, and said, what's the big deal? Gehazi said, are you not seeing what I'm seeing? And Elisha said, oh, wait a minute. You're actually not seeing what I'm seeing. Lord, open his eyes. He said, all of a sudden, my eyes were opened, and I saw chariots of fire that filled the mountainside. And Elisha said, see, they that be with us are more than they that be with them. You know, I just like to point out that when Elisha first saw a chariot of fire, it was when Elijah went up into the heavens, and it was just one of them. But after all those miracles and all that journey and all those trials and all that testimony, the whole mountainside was filled with chariots that burned with fire. And it was the angelic host of God. Let me tell you something. That fiery trial you're going through, that's just God adding another chariot to your fleet. I'm just getting another chariot. I'm just getting another chariot. I'm just getting more fortitude. Gehazi said, I got miracles. I got more miracles I could tell you about. He said, you know what my favorite one is? I got to tell you my favorite one. He said, my absolute favorite miracle has to do with this little woman from Shunem. Man, King, she was amazing. And he really did like this miracle because he was integrally involved in it. He said, this woman from Shunem, she just was spectacular. She was such a great lady. She would watch the prophet Elisha come and do his ministry. And she got to thinking, man, I wish I could do something for the prophet Elisha. And so she did. And he said she just made a little chamber for him and put it there. And every time he stopped by, her husband would prepare a place for him to stay. And she told her husband, said, he comes here all the time. We might as well make a little place for him to be comfortable and find rest. So she gave her husband a honey-do list, and he goes to work building this chamber, and they put a stool in there, they put a candlestick in there, they put a bed in there, they made it just nice and comfortable, put a table, and they would go there. And Elisha was overwhelmed by her kindness, and Gehazi's telling this story, and he asked me what we should do for her. And I'm thinking, what should Elisha do for her? I mean, if it's just anybody else, we'd give her a gift card. But it's Elisha. We could do something else. And he said, you know, I've noticed that there aren't any smudges on the window panes. I've noticed there's no little jungle gym in the backyard. I've noticed there's no little toys in the corner of the living room. I tell you what, they're a sweet couple, but I bet they want children. He said, we ought to pray that they could have children. And Elisha said, perfect. That's what we'll give them. We'll give them a baby. And Elisha said to that woman of Shunem, he said, you're going to have a child. And she said, oh, don't play with me like that. She said, you're touching the nerve center of my heart now. Wait a minute. She said, I can't play games like that. Are you serious? He said, I'm not messing with you. You're going to have a child. And she did have a child. Isn't that an awesome story? But as I said, it's not done. It goes on. The child grows up, is doing great. And one day in the field, he's working with his father. And to his father's shock and horror, he looks up to his dad and just says, Dad, my head. Dad, my head, my head. And he falls to the ground unconscious. And they gather him up. The mother comes out, the woman of Shunem. She sees her child dead, and she said, gather him up and go put him on the prophet's bed. See, she didn't even know why she was making that little chamber. It wasn't just for the man of God. It was for the man of God and the miracles of God. You don't even know why you give what you give. You don't even know why you do what you do. You just feel the prompting of the Holy Ghost. But I want you to know God sees exactly what's going to come from that labor of love. Put him on the prophet's bed, and she gets on a donkey and rides to the prophet. And when she gets there, they see her coming a long ways off. And Gehazi and Elisha are looking out saying, well, who is that? It looks like the woman of Shunem. And they run to her, and Gehazi said, is everything okay? She said, it is well. Death back at home, but it is well. Trials more than I can bear, but it is well. Hardship and difficulty, but it is well. I would to God that we would get the it isn't well out of our mouth and say, it is well. All is well. Everything. Oh, I feel like if you don't, my God, I feel the Holy Ghost. If you don't leave here with anything else today, you leave here with this. When you put it in the hands of God, everything is going to be all right. Problems, hardships, pain, difficulty, but it is well with my soul. She's saying, it is well. She gets down before Elisha and falls at his feet, weeping and wailing. And Elisha, now I want you to notice the pragmatism of this miracle, because we're used to the miracles of the Bible and we just kind of skip over them. And Moses stretched out his rod upon the waters, and the waters parted hither and thither. And we forget how dramatic these things really were and how much humanity was involved. But Elisha steps back and says, oh, her soul is vexed, and the Lord hath hid it from me. Elisha said, this caught me off guard. I didn't know stuff could catch Elisha off guard. But Elisha said, yeah, this totally catches me off guard. The Lord didn't make me aware of this. And her heart is vexed. And they find out, she said, that son you promised. She said, I told you not to play games with me. I told you that if this is too good to be true, I can't handle it. And Elisha said to Gehazi, Gehazi said, he talked to me. And said, here, take my staff and go to the house and go to the chamber and you stretch my staff over that child. And man, can you imagine what that woman is feeling, the relief she's feeling? Gehazi makes his way to the bedchamber of the prophet and stretches the prophet's staff over the child, and nothing happened. I'm going to tell you something. We can pray and ask God for miracles and nothing happened. And that's when a lot of us give up. And a lot of us default to saying, well, it must just be the will of God. I prayed. I stretched the rod of God over the situation. I did everything I knew to do and it still hasn't been resolved. I'm going to tell you something. You let God let you know it's His will. Our job is to pray. Our job is to intercede. Our job is to boldly approach the throne of grace. Our job is to talk in tongues till the miracle comes. Our job is to bury our face in prayer. Our job is to seek the face of God. You let God say it's His will. We don't jump to that conclusion. It could have been God's will for that child to just be gone, but they didn't know and they weren't sure. And so Gehazi comes back to Elisha and said, I did what you told me to do. Nothing happened. And man, that's usually when we look at the woman of Shunem and say, I'm so sorry for your loss. Elisha said, I'm going. And Elisha goes to the bedchamber. And the Bible says that Elisha stretched himself. Ooh, hallelujah. We could preach on that a little while. Stretching yourself. He stretched himself out over the child, eyes to his eyes, hands to his hands, and nothing happened. Man, you talk about it must be the will of God for this child to just go the way of the grave. But Elisha paced back and forth, and he did it again, stretched himself out over that child. Until the child came back to life. And Gehazi is in the middle of telling that story, and he said, it's my favorite miracle of Elisha. Man, and that little kid came back to life, and just is, I hear they're doing great. We're not friends on Facebook or anything, but my understanding is that they're doing great and all is well. And all of a sudden, the door of the king's throne room creaks open. And the Shunammite woman walks in. And the young man who is her son is standing there with her. And she is there pleading for her land back, pleading for her money back, pleading for everything she had lost. The prophet Elisha told her 7 years earlier to go because of the famine, that God would take care of everything. Don't you worry about anything. And what she didn't know is that while she was gone and all seemed lost and all seemed forgotten, God was working on Gehazi, preparing a testimony. I want you to get over your condemnation. I want you to get over your regret. I want you to get over the mistakes you made. You got to tell the story. I let you see things, and you've got to go tell the king. She had no idea, but while she was making her way back to her land to reclaim it, God had anointed Gehazi to stand in the throne room of the king, saying, let me tell you about the goodness of the Lord. Let me tell you about the miracles of God. Let me tell you about the power of his spirit. And when she walked in, the king's heart was made ready. He said, I'm giving it all back to you. Everything you lost, it's all going to be restored to you. I'm preaching to people with regret today. You may think you lost everything, but you did not lose your testimony. You did not lose the fact that God did do a work in your life. You may not have lived the way you wanted to live, and you might have made mistakes that other people know about, and you might have people saying, isn't Gehazi the guy that took all that money from Naaman and then lied to Elijah? Forget all that. Let God be true and every man a liar. Step back into the testimony. God's getting ready to restore the years that the locust hath eaten, that the canker worm hath eaten, that the caterpillar and the palmer worm hath eaten. It's time to dance again. It's time to shout again. It's time to preach again. It's time to sing again. It's time to teach again. Come on, man of God. It's time to lead your family again. Come on, woman of God. It's time to bring your family back to church. It's time to testify. Come on, Gehazi, lift up those hands, lift up that voice, and declare the glory of God. Glory, glory, glory. Glory. He's getting ready to resolve that in your spirit right now. He's getting ready to reconcile some things in your mind right now. He's getting ready to stop the spiral of your emotions right now. And he's going to give you peace that passes understanding. You know what? I want to do something here. I want to do something here. I want everybody that's ever made a mistake to come to the front of the house. I want everybody who's got stuff there, wish they could go back and redo. I want everybody who wishes that it hadn't happened like it did, that you could push rewind. You can't push rewind, but you can repent. You can't go back and change it, but God can change you. Come on, I want somebody to bring regret to God right now. Bring condemnation to God right now. Bring shame to God right now and say, I don't know what to do with this. God's going to fill your mouth with his testimony. He's going to fill your mouth with his goodness and glory. I want you to give the stuff you can't change. I want you to lift it up to God right now. Say, God, I can't change what happened, but I need you to step in and breathe life into this dead body again. I need you to step in and bring joy to this situation. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in darkest night. You are close like no other.
I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. Fire in darkest night, you are close.